I greet you all in the wonderful name of Jesus. Thank you that we can all gather together and even speak to you, those that listen to us. We want to say that God is almighty, and that character of His does not change. You realize that if you realize the might of our God, you realize His capability. You realize that even He Himself can stop time. Because you know in the Bible that the sun stood still for a few moments. And you find that God Himself can stop time in such a way for your favor. He's a God that has said in His word that call unto me and I will answer you. Thank you, Jesus. I was listening to the word. I was listening to some of the songs, and when I was spending some time in worship, and sometimes some of the songs sounded a bit different than what some of the CDs sound. Like I sing the song, Lord, You Are Good, and it's not how generally people do it. But there's one thing you must realize, that each church, and just like each person, has a personality. And so does each church has a personality. And sometimes you find that even if you may want your music, even the musicians as well, we want to tell you, you may want your music to be exactly as the CD is. But it's the same thing as if your brother played the CD on a Sunday morning. There is good in, there's much in excellence, there's much in perfection. But when that becomes a focus, rather than worshiping God, that's why I tell musicians must spend time in worship. Musicians must be engaged, fully engaged in worship. Not just worried about the nitty-gritty of music. I know sometimes we get caught up in how the music sounds and how the music must be, and each part must come in as the CD does. And it's good. There's nothing wrong with it. But the mere focus must be Jesus Himself. God sees your motive. Because sometimes we get mistaken. We rather our music becomes concerts rather than worship. It's so important. That's why I say, it does not matter if a song does not sound exactly like the CD. It is your personality. Just as how everyone has their own thumbprint. No one has the same thumbprint. So you must not care. You just sing to the Lord. He's not worried whether it sounds exactly like the CD. He's worried how you sing it and whether it's meant from your heart. So God's attitude towards you is that be yourself. Be yourself with Him. Rather than you put up a form of godliness, a form of church attire, but be yourself with Him. Come with Him as you are. God says there's a welcome. There's a welcome that's available to you day and night. And today this message is something that has touched my heart. The message that we realize, and we fail to realize, the Bible says that Jesus is our high priest. And this message came to me in a global prayer that we had. We had a global prayer meeting, and this word came to me. And I thought about sharing it with those of you that listen to us, and those of you that haven't been there. It was a blessed time. We saw people growing in God, we saw the different aspects of Jesus, and the entire global prayer was only about Jesus. It was about a week or so, 10 days or so, of prayer and celebration of Jesus. But he spoke about the different aspects of Jesus. And I remember I was given the one on the priesthood, Jesus as our priest, as our high priest. And there was a brother that spoke the word. And this is the word that came to me. I was given to pray at the time. And you find that this is the word that is brought to me in my heart. And I shared it with those that were there. And it was a blessing, not just to them, but to me as well. And I will share it to you. It's basically, it's God teaches us how to pray. And God gives us a pattern of prayer. And we spoke about this, that where we have the Lord's Prayer. But you find that the Lord's Prayer teaches us more than that. If you look at Psalms 100 verse 4, it says, enter His gates with thanksgiving. Enter His courts with praise. That alone, that scripture alone will tell us something as we link it to Matthew verse 6. Matthew verse 6 talks about the Lord's Prayer. Jesus' pattern of prayer. And I mentioned this last time that Jesus' prayer was in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus' prayer was, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. But when Jesus gave you some Matthew 6 prayer where he said, Our Father who art in heaven, Jesus was saying, when you pray like this. Jesus was giving us a pattern of prayer. But Jesus, when he prayed, Father, take this cup of suffering away from me. That was Jesus' prayer. But not my will, but your will be done. And then you find that Jesus is our high priest. Amen? That means the duty of the high priest at those times, in the days of old, was to go into the Holy of Holies. Only the high priest was allowed into the Holy of Holies. Now the Holy of Holies was a place in the temple that was built for God. The temple of Solomon was built in honor to God. And God gave him the design, God gave him all the furniture that you need to build. He gave him the design of it. And he told him exactly how it should be. And each thing speaks about Jesus himself. Each aspect, now that is a study on its own, but I just want to give you an idea of how Jesus becomes our high priest. And Jesus is a high priest. And how you must see yourself, if he is the King of Kings, so he is the high priest of high priests. So that means if God has invited you, when he broke the curtain, when he broke the veil, when he died, they said the veil was torn in two. And we know exactly at the point when Jesus died, the veil that separated all the people from going into the Holy of Holies was broken too, was torn in two. And you find that that was an invite for all of us to go into the Holy of Holies. Now, what happened was, the high priest's job was to go and make atonement for the people. And he should go into the Holy of Holies once a year. But one of the things that he had was, he had a string that was tied to him. This string was tied to him, which was long enough to reach outside the court. And on the string, on his leg, on his ankle, he had a bell. And this bell used to be sounding as he moves. Now, if this high priest had sin in his life, he would have died instantly and the bell would stop moving. So that's how now the people had to pull him out using the string. Why? Because there's no compromise for sin. God cannot compromise his holiness. God has made his holiness, his level of excellence known to you. And there's only one way, his holiness. Now we thank God that we don't have that kind of penalty for sin this day and age. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. But there was one death that was paid for us all, and that is Jesus Christ our Lord. And yet again I will say that it does not give you a license to sin. So, the people used to pull the high priest out, so he was the only one allowed to go in there. So Jesus was our high priest. But when he made a way for us to go into the Holy of Holies, he basically was saying that you are now an high priest. You can go into the Holy of Holies. And look at the beauty of it. Let's walk through the temple of God and see how the scriptures link and teach us something. Firstly, we come into the temple of God. We see we have the gate. Bible says, enter his gates with thanksgiving. Psalms 100. And we're standing right at the gate of the temple. And what we need to do? You see, when you come to God in prayer, when you come to God with a prayerful life, when you come to God in a relationship, you always realize that you should be thankful. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Now, the very fact that you have so much to be thankful for to God will allow you to realize that, hey, before I start even talking to God, I must not forget what he's done for me. That is why you find when the lepers were healed by Jesus, only one came back to say thank you. And let's not forget saying thank you. We find thank you is a word that's hardly used in this day and age. Thank you and sorry. These two words that's hardly used in this day and age. People are fighting for the fact that they are right. And people forget what little you do. You know, sometimes people say and take what little you do for them as, you know what, it was your obligation to do it. Or you had to do it. Or you know what, it's part of what you are, part of the role that you play. I don't need to thank you for it. But it's so important that even Jesus himself says, enter his gates with thanksgiving. So you need to say, thank you, Father. Thank you for the last time I spoke to you. I can see there's some results here. Last time I asked you this, Lord, I can see that there is some change. But Lord, you know what? Even though there is no change, I thank you that you heard me. I know that you heard me, Lord. I thank you that, you know what, I'm here alive for getting to see another day. I'm here alive to walk closer to your plan and destiny you have for my life. Lord, I'm here today to be an impact to somebody else, and I thank you for that. I thank you that you have a plan for my life. I thank you that you have a destiny for my life. I thank you that today, whatever is you're going to unfold, that you will see me through. I thank you for loving me. I thank you for dying on the cross for me. I thank you for forgiving me of my sins. I thank you for calling me righteous.